Hello, hello, Mordimers here, and welcome back to Magnus Carlsen Chess Tour Finals, day two of the tournament. And yesterday I showed you the game between Magnus Carlsen and Dean Liren. This time I would like to show you another pairing. So Daniil Dubov, who's gonna play in this game as black, and Hikaru Nakamura, who's gonna play as white. And this is game number three. We had the two draws, and this is the first decisive game. So without further ado, let's see what happened on the board. Hikaru opened with e4 and we have c5, Sicilian defense on the board. Knight f3, knight c6, d4, open Sicilian. C takes on d4, knight takes on d4, knight f6 and knight c3. Pretty standard, everything is pretty standard. And here Daniil Dubov gonna choose the variation and he goes for e5. So we have Svechnikov variation on the board. And why is it called Svechnikov variation? Yes, you are correct, because it was played by Emmanuel Lasker for the first time over 100 years ago. And then it was improved by Jiří Pelikán, a Czech-Argentinian grandmaster, later in 50s of 20th century. So in some books you can find the name of the variation as a Lasker-Pelikán variation. However, Svechnikov improved that even further in the 70s of 20th century. This is why in the most of the modern theory it's called Svechnikov variation. Now, what is the idea? Kick the knight, of course, and also get d4 and f4 under, you know, black control. The pawn controls these squares. And now what white usually play is knight d2 b6. So first idea is to jump with the knight to d6 and deliver a check. And if black takes with the bishop, then the queen gonna go to d6. So black will want to exchange the queens. So that is the main idea. Another idea is bishop to g5. Exchange this knight, and then this knight can actually jump to d5 and get the very beautiful outpost where it can't actually be attacked by any pawns, and it's, you know, very happy over there. So some players play h6 just to prevent that, but then, you know, they allow actually the knight jump to d6, which is not convenient. So the main line is actually d6. This is what Daniil Dubov played, and now we have bishop g5. The main line continues, a6, kicking the knight. And here Hikaru Nakamura actually played plenty of times the variation where he immediately takes the knight. So he could play that as well. And then the main idea here is after g takes on f6, knight a3. The problem is black get a very sharp position and can get some counterplay with f5, and both sides actually can have some attacking chances. However, Hikaru Nakamura here goes for another variation, knight a3, more silent, you know, a more calm variation. We have b5, and this is Chelyabinsk variation, and it was invented by Mr. Svechnikov. The main idea is to get the c4 under control, so the knight cannot get back to the game through c4 square. So that is the main idea. Now b4 is the threat, so that is the another idea of that move. So this is why knight d5 here, and now bishop e7 and bishop f6 as planned. Bishop f6 and now c3, taking under control d4 square, and rook b8 by Daniil Dubov. Knight c2, so getting to the game this way. We have bishop g5, making a space for the main developing idea, f5, attacking the center and also bringing the bishop to the game this way. However, first a4, counter attack on the queen side. This is still theory by Hikaru Nakamura. B takes on a4, knight c2 b4, and now knight b4 and c takes on b4. And here Daniil Dubov has a choice, because his pawn is under attack twice and this pawn is also under attack once. So how to play? The main line here is actually castle, and after rook a4, play a5, which is pretty sneaky, because if the pawn is taken, this rook can take the pawn on b2, and the king is still in the center. It can be very, very dangerous. For example, bishop can come to d2, and it's already, you know, very unpleasant for white. This is why b5 is usually played, and then bishop d7, the game can continue, but black has quite good chances here. However, Daniil Dubov prefers another variation, and he played bishop d7. He played that couple of times against strong opponents, however, usually the games ended in the draw, but definitely he knows what he is playing. We have bishop a6 as planned, and now castle by Daniil Dubov. b3, a takes on b3, queen takes on b3, and now the queen is on this diagonal. So before f5, Daniil still has to, you know, prepare. So he played king h8, and we have in the database couple of games where bishop e6 is played. And then bishop c4 is the main move here, and after queen d7, castle, and then bishop d2 with the attack on the pawn. This is one of the idea here. So the knight defender of the pawn is attacked, so rook a4 and then rook f to c8. So this is the main idea for the black rooks in this opening, and in the database we have a couple of draws here. Also another idea is queen e8, queen e8 with the idea of bishop on b5, and then this bishop can actually control f1, and white gonna stay with the king in the center. So this is white have to castle first, and after king h8 the game can continue. Bishop c4 again, this is the main idea here. And then f5, e takes on f5, bishop f5, b5, and still we have still 8 games in the database. All of them were drawn, so very drawish continuation, and it's very difficult to actually be creative here. And this is what Hikaru Nakamura said, that this opening, you know, it's very difficult to be creative. So he doesn't know why actually Daniil Dubov went for that variation. Here Daniil Dubov makes a different move order. First he goes for king h8, which makes quite a lot of sense, and now we have castle. And here we have queen e8. So different move order, however, the idea is the same. Play f5, bring the queen to h5, maybe to f7, put the pressure on f2, maybe h2, up to the what white gonna play. We have bishop e2. Normally bishop c4 is played and is a very well-known variation, but Hikaru goes for bishop e2. And now f5 as planned. E takes on f5, bishop on f5, and now pushing b5. We have bishop e6, so he thought, okay, if bishop is not on c4, it's probably good to pin that knight. And Hikaru doesn't care much. Rook a6, so he makes some counterplay. Now he attacks the pawn on d6. Now, what to play as black? Daniil Dubov doesn't care about the pawn, and he played queen f7, attacking the knight twice. And now the problem is the rook actually cannot take on d6. Yes, it's defending the knight, however, after bishop e7 the rook is quite trapped. So of course if the rook is moved, then the knight is under attack, so white would have to give up the exchange, and black gonna have the winning position. This is why Hikaru Nakamura goes for bishop c4. And now we have rook f to d8 by Daniil Dubov. However, Hikaru said rook f to c8 would be more natural in this position, attacking the bishop, and bishop is the defender of the knight, so white would have to play rook d1, and the game can continue. This is in the spirit of the opening and the continuation of the Sveshnikov. It's very well known theory. However, we have rook f to d8, preparing this pawn to being pushed. However, how to push if the knight is still, you know, on the d5? We have rook d1 by Hikaru Nakamura, and now e4. So Daniil Dubov has some idea here, and Hikaru thought that, okay, bishop g4, this is the idea, attacking the rook. So the rook would have to be moved from the d file, and there could be some ideas to remove the knight. However, it's still, you know, unclear how to exactly do that. For now, Hikaru Nakamura doesn't care and just push the pawn. We have rook f8, now attacking the f2, and now rook a2, defending. Bishop d8, now attacking this pawn twice, and although it's defended twice, however, one of the defenders is attacked by the bishop. So it's, you know, something going on here. Rook b2, overprotecting a b6, and now bishop d5 would not work here, because after bishop d5 the queen is under attack, so queen have to be moved, and now the pawn can be pushed and everything is fine with the white position. So this is why Daniil Dubov play queen h5 first, and now White have to be very careful. If play any slow move like king h1, it doesn't make any sense. However, I want to show you, you know, what's gonna happen. Then we have bishop b6. And after knight b6, the problem is this knight defends the bishop. However, bishop c4 and the knight cannot take because the queen is under attack. Also, queen cannot take because the rook is under attack. So it's very, very tricky position. Queen c2 would have to be played, but then rook f2 with the attack on the queen, and then queen f2, queen d1, and after exchanging everything, black has two extra passed pawns in the center, completely winning position. So very, very tricky position by Daniil Dubov, and Hikaru have to be very, very precise. He plays queen c2, the best move in the position. So now the rook and the knight actually defends. We have bishop f5 now. Bishop on d5 still doesn't work because the rook can take with the tempo on the queen. So that's not possible. This is why we have bishop f5. And this move was really criticized by Hikaru Nakamura. He said it doesn't make any sense. First of all, bishop h4, this is the main idea with the attack on f2, okay? So that's the main idea, and it does something, and this move just does nothing. Okay, there is some threat like e3, however, it's, you know, it doesn't matter much. So bishop h4 should be played, and let's say after g3, bishop g5, rook db1, black can try to play on the light squares. However, the light square bishop is still on the board. The queen can come also to e2, try to exchange the queen, so on. So that was possible. However, bishop f5 was played, and now simply queen d2. So there are no e3 moves now, or actually e3 could be played by Daniil Dubov. He could continue. And it's pretty interesting variation, much more active than what Daniil Dubov played. After e3, the knight cannot take because the pawn is under attack and it's very, very precious pawn. And the queen cannot take because the queen is watching a d1. So f takes on e3, and now after bishop e4, black gonna have quite interesting gameplay. Knight f4 is possible to attack the queen, but queen can remaneuver with the attack on the bishop. And yes, there is some fork here. However, look at this. Knight f8, bishop gonna win this dangerous pawn, and after, let's say, rook c1, kicking the queen, but queen can very nice remaneuver to f7 first, and after rook f1, defending the knight, queen can move to a7. And this is a pretty dangerous position, actually, for white. White have to be very careful. Another bishop also slicing over here, so white have to be very, very precise. So it was possible to actually push e3, however Daniil Dubov goes back, so bishop e6 again. And now this actually allow Hikaru Nakamura play the best move in the position. He didn't go for b7. b7 is also possible. However, there are some ideas like bishop a5 with attack on the queen. The queen is still watching at d1, so queen c2 and black have some counterplay. However, Hikaru goes for very, very simple and very strong move. Knight e3. Now, look at this. The queen attacks d6, so if the bishop is moved somewhere, black gonna lose very important pawn, the only counterplay they have. And also, the knight defends d1 and also defends the bishop. So, actually, there is the one choice, and it's also blocking the pawn from marching. So, actually, there is only one move for black, and it's bishop c4. We have knight c4, and now bishop f6, trying to consolidate with tempo attacking the rook. We have rook b to b1 and now rook f to d8, saying, okay, you're gonna push your pawn, I'm gonna push my pawn. Your knight moved from the d5, so now I have, you know, the way for my pawn. We have b7, d5 as planned, knight a5, and now the knight actually threatens the fork. So bishop e5 first by Daniil Dubov, attacking h2, Hikaru Nakamura prevents that, g3, and now queen g6. defending c6. We have queen c2, so now Hikaru Nakamura say, I'm gonna jump there, and now rook d6. Daniil Dubov say, no, you're not gonna jump there, and now we have rook d to c1. So the threat is very, very simple. Checkmate on the 8th rank. And here Daniil Dubov actually play bishop f4. However, he is in very difficult situation and it's difficult to find the move for him. He played bishop f4, attacking c1. And of course the bishop cannot be taken because of the pin. And now Hikaru Nakamura is fixed on his idea with the queen c8. He wants to sacrifice the queen, so this is the queen sacrifice. However, he had a much better move in that position. Knight c6 is just winning on the spot. And now if bishop c1, then knight b8, very simple. The bishop retreat, but the knight also retreat. And in the next move, we're gonna have the queen. So it doesn't work. If the rook is moved, then simply queening. And now taking the queen is not possible because the checkmate on the 8th rank. So that's not also not possible. Rook b7, sacrifice the rook. Okay, but white gonna be, you know, up the rook. And even black even cannot take this rook because, again, there is the checkmate on the 8th rank. And finally, rook c6. This looks the best. However, it doesn't work as well. Queen c6, bishop c1, and now queen c8 with check. Queen e8. And after queen e8, rook e8, queening. And of course, again, the rook cannot take the queen because there is the checkmate. So that's the biggest problem. So knight c6 is, you know, crushing move. However, Hikaru Nakamura goes for queen c8, and it's still winning move. However, it's probably the worst of all the winning move because now we have rook d8, queen to d8. So this is the second queen sacrifice. And now black doesn't have much choice. Rook d8, and now rook c8 by Hikaru Nakamura. And Daniil Dubov actually missed the move h5. He could go for h5. It's still losing move. However, after rook d8, king h7, and promoting, the bishop can take the queen. And after rook b to b8, the game, you know, still can be continued. White have one extra knight. Black has this passed pawn, has also some counterplay maybe. Okay, that's maybe too much fantasy from my side. However, this is the best what black could get. However, Daniil Dubov play queen e8 with the seconds on his clock. So he just didn't see everything. And after rook d8, queen d8, g takes on f4, he resigned. And he resigned because in the next move, white gonna promote and black can only, you know, stop it. But after knight c6, there is no way for black actually to stop promoting. The only way is actually to sacrifice the queen. So this is, of course, winning for white. This is why after g takes on f4, the bishop is eliminated and the game is lost. So that's the game, and I would like to show you also the standings. So here we go, we have the semifinals. Magnus Carlsen actually managed to win with Ding Liren. He won first two games, and then he just needed a draw in the third game. So very comfortable win today. So he equalized, both players have 1 point. Just reminder, whoever get 3 points, then of course gonna advance to the finals. And in the second semi-final, Hikaru Nakamura managed to win in the not only third game, but also in the fourth game. So he won also very confidently 3-1, and he got his second point. So he need only one more win to get to the final. So that's the standings. I hope you enjoyed that. And if yes, then press like. If for some reason you didn't like this video, press unlike. And if you don't want to miss any other games on my channel, press subscribe, smash the bell button. Thanks for watching and see you in the next one.